I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, welcome to Advent 2. We're still in this anticipatory mode where we're like I mentioned last week, we're in the already but not yet, and we're in that middle section of waiting. We've been in it for 2 millennia, and for the foreseeable future, we're going to be in it. So we might as well get comfortable, right? Today we hear about the birth and the putting forward of John, John's calling to be something other than a priest in the church. He is presented to us from parents who are both from a priestly line. His father is a priest and does rounds in the temple. His father was a priest, and his mother comes from a line of priests that goes all the way back to Aaron. So you would think that John would be a priest in the line, in kind of the family business, but he's not. He is filled with the Holy Spirit at a very early age in the womb, and still in the womb, and winds up being called as a prophet. And this Luke showing him as a prophet harkens back to Ezekiel, to Jeremiah, Hosea, and to Isaiah. All of them start out kind of in the same way. I wanted to focus real quick on Ezekiel because it's a pretty quick little blurb. Chapter 1 in Ezekiel, verses 2 and 3. On the fifth day of the month, it always starts out with kind of this time stamp. In the fifth year of the exile of King Jehoiakim, the word of the Lord came to Ezekiel, the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans by the Chebar Canal, and the hand of the Lord was upon him there. So we see this kind of this once upon a time, we see John in this ancient tradition of Old Testament prophets. And that's the way Luke wants to frame him through this lens of Old Testament prophets. And he does this in such a way that we see there's an A-list of all of these earthly powers that are around him. There's an emperor, there's a governor, three tetrarchs, and two high priests, basically representing all the power and authority that was available at that time. There was wealth, there was military prowess, there was ancestry, all of that combined to have this kind of encompassing power of all the known world at that time. And John was dropped right in the middle of that. We have names like Tiberius and Pilate and Herod Antipas, Philip, Lysanias, Annas and Caiaphas. All of these are names that represent all of the authority, the priestly authority, the empirical authority, the military authority that pretty much lit up the world at that time, and it all was a time stamp for when John was dropped into the scene. And John is not ministering in the midst of this, right in the midst of all this in Jerusalem. No, John is ministering out in the very far edges of the kingdom, what is referred to as the wilderness. Now, this wilderness, the Greek word eremos, or desert or deserted place, we get things from Luke. We get things like testing and hunger in chapter 9. We get danger or destruction in 15 and in 21, chapters 15 and 21, lost and found in also in chapter 15. And if we go back even beyond the Lucan description of this eremos, this desert or deserted place, we see God guiding God's people, the Israelites, through this, a pillar of smoke by day, a pillar of fire by night. We see him providing manna. It's a place of provision. We see the feast of the multitudes in Luke, out in the wilderness, out in this deserted place in chapter 9. We see God encountering God's people and allowing God's people to depend on God in this desert or deserted place. And that's where we find John today. We find John dropped right in the middle of this narrative, in the middle of all the power in Luke's gospel, of all the power of the known world at that time. And John is right in the middle of that ministering. And what is he doing? He has two parts to his mission. The one is very overt. He has come to make paths straight, to level mountains, to straighten out the curves, to make a way for the Lord, to make things easier for the Lord. But the other one that is not quite as seen is he's come to prepare the people. And how do we know that? Because he is baptizing with a baptism of repentance. That's preparing the people to receive this great King that is on the way. And that's what we are in Advent. We're waiting for that great King to come to us, not as a baby, not as a baby, not as a child in a manger, but as a conqueror, a divine being coming to us out of the words of Revelation, coming to us to straighten out the barbed wire and to make things like they're supposed to be, not perverted and twisted like they are now, but very much like they were supposed to be and God meant them to be. Listen, we're in the midst of, and I say this, I keep saying this, and I don't mean to beat a dead horse by it, we're in the midst of a pandemic. We're 2 years into this, and right when we think it's over, Omicron hits, and it just gives us pause. Some of us are so ready to go back to the way things were. So many of us are ready for what's new and what's coming on the other side of this. But all of us are wanting this to end. We are in the middle of our desert wandering. We're in the middle of this deserted, this place that's deserted and in need of God. And where do we find God? In the Bible, we find God leading God's people in the wilderness. It's where people learn to depend on God. It's where we learn to depend on God. And so don't be afraid of the desert. Don't be afraid to worship God, to pray to God, to have a relationship with God in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of our desert, because that's where we learn to depend on God. That's where we learn to depend on the one who offers us and brings us salvation, not through a baby, but through the life, death, resurrection, ascension of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Folks, as we're going through Advent, it is a real time to set your house in order. It's a real time to trim your wicks, to make sure your lamps have full of oil. I'm using Bible passages. Look them up. They're really great. And it's time for us to be getting our house in order, because we don't know. Even the Son of Man doesn't know. Only the Father in heaven knows when Jesus is coming back. Now, I don't want to scare you and say it's going to happen tomorrow, because I don't know that. But what we do know is that in our desert places, we encounter God, and we need to be prepared for that encounter. We need to be, if the bridegroom comes, we need to be ready for that, right? But even if the bridegroom doesn't come, we still need to be ready to encounter God in our desert places. And Lord knows we're in a desert place now. In the middle of this pandemic, it's hard to get together. That's the reason this is happening, because we can't get together for whatever reason. And I want you to know and to be encouraged that God is with us, and God brings us that salvation, even in our desert places. If you haven't studied the Desert Fathers, you realize very quick, or mothers and fathers, you realize very quickly that it's where, when these people are in the desert or these deserted places, this Eremos, these deserted places, that they encounter God in a very deep and spiritual way. And so I offer to you that you may be at home, you might be isolated, you may be in fear, you may be in danger, you may not feel well. All of these things put you in your deserted place, your desert. Seek God in those times. Pray to God. Ask God for help. And then don't turn away from God, but turn towards God. Turn your face towards God and allow God to minister to you, because he does bring salvation. He does bring salvation to us. Even today, 2,000 years later, after Christ's death, resurrection, ascension, God is still bringing us to salvation. It never stops. It never stops. It never stops. I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.